Last time, we left off with a mystery. What is the mathematical connection between the lengths and tensions of strings that sound good together? Let's start with length. The simplest pattern I see is that strings with the same length sound good together. This is not too surprising, since these strings are at the same tension and have the same length, they should make pretty much the same sound. Now, what about our other pairs of strings that sound good together? If we look at the third row of our table, we see that our second string is fixed to a length of 60 centimeters. And the lengths of our first string that sound good with our second are 60, 45, 40, 30, and 20 centimeters. Now, what do these numbers have in common? Well, if we divide the length of our first string by the length of our second string, we see that the strings that sound good together do have something interesting in common. The ratio of their lengths all reduce to simple fractions, while the ratios of the lengths of strings that do not sound good together do not reduce to simple fractions. This was the first discovery of Pythagoras. Strings sound good together when the ratio of their lengths is simple. Now let's have a look at tension. Maybe the same simple ratio rule applies. If we divide the tensions of our first string by our second, we see that the tensions that sound good together do result in relatively simple ratios. However, some string tensions that don't sound good together, such as 3.6 and 1.8 kilograms, also reduce to very simple ratios. So it seems that the hidden mathematical relationship between string tension and sound must be a bit deeper. If we have a closer look at the tensions of strings that sound good together, we may see a hint of a deeper pattern. Notice that quite a few of our good-sounding tension ratios are exactly equal to the ratios of perfect squares. Following this hunch, let's take the square root of our tension ratios. Remarkably, this simple transformation snaps our problem into focus. Our new square roots of ratios are simple when our string combinations sound good together, and complex when our strings don't sound good together. This was Pythagoras' second remarkable discovery. Strings sound good together when the square root of the ratio of their tensions is simple. This information was helpful for early instrument makers. But what's really interesting here is how these discoveries changed the way we humans think about the universe we live in. These discoveries, along with another interesting Pythagorean discovery involving right triangles, really got Pythagoras and his followers thinking. Why is it that mathematics is able to predict what we observe in the world around us? Division, square roots, fractions, and even numbers kind of seem like human inventions. Why are they showing up so clearly in triangles and vibrating strings? These mysteries were compelling enough to convince the Pythagoreans of something that might sound a little far-fetched today. That our world is literally built from mathematics. This may sound ridiculous, but we don't actually have to look very far to find very bright modern-day physicists who believe this. Now, whether or not our universe is built from math is still open for debate. But what I think is really interesting here is what we do with this mystery. For the Pythagoreans, this was basically it. Why does mathematics show up in vibrating strings and triangles? Because the universe is built from math. Mystery solved. It would take a couple thousand more years for us humans to really start probing what I think is the more interesting question. How deep does the connection between mathematics and our universe go? If we can predict when two strings sound good together, what else can we predict? In the case of our vibrating strings, what actually makes our strings sound good or bad together? Can we use math to really understand what happens when a string vibrates? Answering questions like this required one more piece of the scientific puzzle that the Pythagoreans never really committed to: experimentation. It may seem obvious to us now, but it took quite some time for us humans to accept what is perhaps the most important idea in all of science.
If it disagrees with experiment, it's wrong. And that simple statement is the key to science. It doesn't make a difference how beautiful your guess is, it doesn't make a difference how smart you are who made the guess, or what his name is. If it disagrees with experiment, it's wrong. That's all there is to it.
When this idea finally started to catch on in 16th century Europe, scientists were finally able to dig into all kinds of mysteries, including the vibrating string. The first real progress came in the form of an educated guess from the Italian scientist Giambattista Benedetti. Benedetti suggested that musical sounds travel through the air as a series of rapid pulses, and how high or low a note sounds to us, its pitch, is a direct result of how frequently these pulses arrive. So if Benedetti's suggestion is true, then the sound we hear from a vibrating string is a direct result of how frequently the string moves back and forth, also known as its frequency of vibration. This idea raised all kinds of new questions. How is a string's frequency of vibration connected to its length and tension? Does anything other than length and tension affect a string's frequency? How can we measure the frequency of real strings when they vibrate back and forth way too quickly for us to see? In the late 1500s, around 50 years after Benedetti guessed that pitch was a direct result of frequency, the great Italian scientist Galileo Galilei turned his attention to these questions. Guided by the work of his father Vincenzo, Galileo made some well-informed guesses at our first two questions that would ultimately turn out to be correct. However, Galileo also claimed that since strings vibrate too fast for us to see, actually measuring their frequency was impossible, meaning that he had no experimental means to test his guesses. But fortunately for us, Galileo was wrong. Within 30 years of Galileo's work, the French priest and scientist Marin Mersenne did measure the frequency of vibrating strings, and was able to experimentally confirm Galileo's guesses. Mersenne was even able to use his methods to compute the frequency of pipe organ notes with around 90% accuracy. So, how did Mersenne do what Galileo said was impossible? What do you think? Given the technology available in the early 1600s, how would you try to figure out how the rate of vibration of a string, its frequency, depends on its length and tension? How would you prove Galileo wrong? For a small hint and some other cool stuff, check out the PDF linked in the description below. Good luck, and thanks for watching.